Thank you. Welcome, friends, family, people watching the live stream.
Exoskeleton. This is a passive exoskeleton built up of springs that you can see with the curves. And this was just to make sure that the user had less of an impact and was less fatigued after running, walking, and jumping. The first powered exoskeleton was the pedometer, which was about 30 years later. And this is a device which people had a compact steam engine strapped to their back. So they'd be running around with boiling hot steam strapped to their back, which sounds like a good idea to me. And it would it went quiet for about 50 years, and then General Electric came with their innovation, and they presented their innovation. And their innovation, or their device, it was able to carry 110 kilograms and make it feel for the user as if he was lifting only 4.5 kilos. This device, I present you the Hardy Man. The Hardy Man, this beautiful aesthetic small device, had one downside. It weighed 680 kilos. Try running around with that. At the same time, around in Belgrade, people they were working on exoskeletons for paraplegics. This is actually an exoskeleton built for paraplegics. And it's the basis for the modern exoskeletons as we know them, or at least our team knows them at the moment. And this exoskeleton was a good step, but the problem was that the person inside the exoskeleton did not have the control over the exoskeleton. So they were pretty scared of walking with the device because they were just walked by the exoskeleton and couldn't do anything they wanted to do. And in the years after that, the innovation kept on going, and now we have the exoskeletons we know, such as the Rewalk, the HAL, or the Exo from Exobionics. And we want to catch on to that innovation, because we believe that in the world of exoskeletons and in the technology, there's still a lot to be improved. And this is our vision for this year.
Thank you.
vision is that the user of the exoskeleton is able to control the steps he or she wants to take. This device you just saw in the video is not our own exoskeleton. That's that exoskeleton we're still building at the moment. It is the Mindwalker, which was developed here at the university. And in this picture, you see the guys who took the initiative for the team, who are also here tonight. And they're from the Nuon Solar team, the earlier teams, and they saw the video of the subathlon, and they thought, hey, we need a student team from Delft who's going to compete in this amazing competition. So this is one of the first interest rinks they hosted, and that's where the team was born. And we started with 9 students just in the beginning of this year, and in September we had the official start of the team. And with this group, we started off in the library here at the TU Delft. This was our first office, and we were very ambitious to get started. So we asked ourselves the basic questions: what is an exoskeleton? How do we build an exoskeleton? And what is a spinal cord injury? We came to the conclusion pretty quickly that with a group of 9 students, building an exoskeleton in 1 year might be a bit too ambitious. So I'd like to present to you the team that we stand with at the moment. A team of 26 students, all from different backgrounds, different disciplines, and different focus in the team. And each role in the team is essential for the success of the team. But what is the effect of a spinal cord injury? A spinal cord injury is damage which is caused by, most of the times, trauma. And the effect is that you have a partial or complete loss of your sensory and motor function in the lower body. And depending on the height, the influence of the spinal cord injury. In a spinal cord injury, you have limitations. Limitations such as going to visit a few friends in Amsterdam and they live on the first floor. Well, try getting up the steep steps with a wheelchair. But also, for example, grabbing something from the top shelf in a supermarket. Also, simple things as going to your favorite rock concert. There's only 10 to 20 tickets available for people in a wheelchair, while all the rest are standing and jumping and dancing around. There are already, of course, certain things that have been done to improve the mobility in a wheelchair. For example, the small 3 steps for in a train, we have a nice ramp for that. But you have to make an appointment, and you have to be at the right time at the right place. So what would be the next improvement? This would be the exoskeleton, which would allow you to stand up from your wheelchair and walk again. The benefits of an exoskeleton are, for example, that you have less back pains, an improved bowel movement, but also that you can go to a cafe, a busy cafe, and just stand around with your friends and have a drink at eye level. Just chatting with someone next to you is, of course, a lot different if you have a difference in height. Exoskeletons have been in the media in the last few months. For example, the Sematis Clinic, who gave the first exoskeleton to people at home. But also, one of the important things at the moment is that a medical board in America decided or concluded that walking isn't a want, it should be a need. And the first exoskeleton has been funded by an insurance company in America. The competition that we are joining in is the Cybathlon, which is the first bionic world games for para athletes. And the organization wants to remove the barriers between people with disability, the public, and with technology developers, which is us, the team. And in this competition, we have to face 6 different obstacles, obstacles you can run into in a wheelchair during daily life. Such as, for example, the chair, a steep ramp that you run into, also tilted surfaces, for example, somewhere where the floor is uneven or you have a sidewalk, etc., and just the simple stairs we have at home. Sorry. Had to happen somewhere. I'd like to present to you, this is the moment, of course, that we are working towards, because we're working towards an exoskeleton. So what is the exoskeleton we believe is fit and able to win the subathlon? And I'd like to present you right now the exoskeleton that we're going to build. Afterwards, Nick is going to take the floor, but enjoy.
I just can't stop looking at it. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the March exoskeleton. This is a device we've been working on so hard for the past 6 months now. My name is Nick Tsutsunaga, and I'm the chief engineer at Project March. And tonight, I will guide you through the design process that we went through as a team to achieve this amazing device. So at around August, we sat down with the team, and we thought, OK, we want to build an exoskeleton for the Cybathlon. How do we do that? Well, the most important thing is that we set out a couple of goals. What do we want to achieve as a team? Well, we set out those goals, and one of the most important goals was we want to perform all the obstacles at the Cybathon. So why do we want to perform all of them? Well, obviously we want to win, that's very important. But the Cybathon sets the bar for what an exoskeleton should be able to do. Because all the obstacles there are things that we, people that can actually walk, take for granted. But people inside wheelchairs see that as an advantage, disadvantage, or as a challenge. So that's the reason why we want to be able to perform all the obstacles. But those are the requirements for the Cybathon. What's next? What's our own vision? What do we want to achieve as a team? Well, we came up with the idea of having a modular design. So why do we want to have a modular design? Well, in such a design process, a lot of things will change while you're testing, while you're designing, and you want to be able to swap out parts really easily. Well, you don't want to take more than 50 minutes to change out a motor or a frame, things like that. So that's why we came up with the modular design. But there's more. We want to have improved compliance. Now, most of you are wondering, what is improved compliance? What is this guy talking about? Well, once you're designing such an exoskeleton, you realize quickly that most of the exoskeletons that are out there right now are very limited in their degrees of freedom, in their ranges of motion. Most exoskeletons walk in a straight line and are very limited in the way you can move in them. Human motion is very natural, and we have a lot of flexibility in our joints, but exoskeletons are limited in that. So we wanted to come up with an idea that allows for more motion, more freedom for the pilot. And that's where the last part comes in, the intuitive suit piloting. What does that mean? Why piloting? Well, once you put on a commercially available exoskeleton, you're actually walked by the exoskeleton. You're not walking it yourself. You're basically a passenger inside. And we want to change that. We want the user of our exoskeleton to be the pilot and not the passenger. So that's the intuitive suit piloting. So let's take a step back and look at the Cybathon a bit closer. There are six obstacles in the cybathlon, but we chose three that are fairly important that I want to discuss right now. First and foremost are the stepping stones, and they can be compared to something like the floor is lava. It requires the exoskeleton to place its feet on precise locations, which are the pebbles behind me. And you cannot place your feet anywhere on the red part. So that requires a lot of flexibility of the exoskeleton so that you can place your feet precisely wherever you want. The second part is a tilted path. These are basically slopes that are tilted on different angles and require a lot of stability from the exoskeleton. And last but not least, the stairs. If robots could dream, this would be their worst nightmare. Walking on stairs for robotic devices is extremely difficult, and we have to find a way to face these challenges. So, like I said, we sat down, and the solution for these problems seemed fairly easy, basically. And the way we solved it is by adding an extra hip joint to the hip structure. If we take a closer look, inside the backpack, we have an extra set of hip joints. Like I said before, most exoskeletons walk in a straight line because they only have one hip joint. Well, we have two. And that allows us not to only walk in a straight line like this, but also sidestepping like this. But that's not all. It allows you to shift your weight from one leg to another. And what that means is that you can walk up the stairs by shifting your weight from one leg to another, like we do as humans. So that also comes back to improved compliance. So most of you are wondering, well, what is that thing sticking out on the top, and what is that round thing? Well, the thing sticking out on the top is the motor, and the round thing is the joint. And together, that module is called a series elastic actuator. So let's take a closer look to a series elastic actuator. What is it, and what does it do? It's basically a motor which enables us to move the exoskeleton. It takes over what your muscles basically do. So I'm going to show you a really important part of the series elastic actuator, which is the spiral spring. And if we can switch to the thing, there we go. This is the titanium spiral spring, and it's a really important part of our exoskeleton. What it does is that it sits between the motor and the joint, and it allows us to very accurately measure the torque inside the joint, but also absorb shocks. And the reason why we want to measure the torque so accurately is because we need to really quickly react to changing environment conditions. You can see it as some sort of a reflex that we have, but now the exoskeleton has it as well. So great, we now have a way to move the exoskeleton, to have it being actuated. But that's not all. We need a way to align these motors, these joints, to the joints of the pilot. So how do we do that? We do that with a frame. And it's not any kind of frame, it's a custom frame made specifically for our pilot. So the idea behind this frame is that we take a 3D scan of the leg of the pilot and we import that into our 3D software. Inside that software, we have the leg of the pilot and we model the frame around that leg. And once it's produced, it is very easy for the pilot to put on this frame, this fixture, or whatever you want to call it, and you don't have to adjust any straps. It sits right in between the exoskeleton and the pilot. But most of you are wondering, well, I don't see any way to attach this to the pilot. How does that work? Well, to explain that is fairly easy. The shape of this frame is so dependent on the 3D scan, and which we haven't made yet, that we only have the structure of the frame and not the way it's attached to the pilot. But we do have a concept. As you can see, the brace or the fixture extends as one part out of the frame and it sits around the leg of the pilot. And with that padding that's in between, we get rid of any strange friction or strange motion between the frame and the pilot's leg. So we've been moving from the top to the bottom of the exoskeleton, and now we're wondering, what does the exoskeleton stand on? Well, it stands on its feet. The human foot or ankle is a fairly complex part. It is made out of a lot of ligaments and bones that move over each other. So we had to design a system that allows for that compliance. And for that, we designed an ankle which has two passive degrees of freedom, as you can see in the video behind me. Now, the feet are not only made to allow to have good compliance, but they also store important sensors that we need. Inside the feet, we have proximity and force sensors. The proximity sensors allow us to measure the distance from the feet to the ground, but it also has four sensors with which we can measure the pressure that is on the feet for improved stability. Now, inside this exoskeleton, we have a lot more sensors in all different parts. With over 100 different sensors, we can measure everything around us, the state of the system and the environment that it is in. So why do we have all these sensors, you're probably wondering? Well, let's take a step back. An exoskeleton or a robotic device is really difficult to control. It needs to know a lot about its environment, what the state is, and what it's doing. We do the same thing. We are basically one giant sensor just walking around. And that's the same for an exoskeleton. And there we go with the video again. It had to go wrong somewhere, like Yella said. No, but I have a video prepared for you which showcases how difficult it is for an exoskeleton to walk, or a robotic device to walk. So yeah, it's not easy. And let's just say we do not want to end up in that video next year. So we like to compare walking with flying a drone. So where does that comparison come from? Well, when we walk, we don't think about what angle our joints have to be in or how much force we have to exert anywhere. No, we just think about where to go, and we go there, like I've been doing the past 5 minutes. Same goes for a drone. You pick up the remote control and you say, I want to go up, I want to go down, I want to left or right, I want to crash into that tree. And you don't have to control all the propellers yourself. No, the computer or the brain inside this drone does that for you. So what does the march do? How do we control the march? Well, the march basically does the same thing. As the pilot, you tell the march where you want to go, and the march does the calculations for you. So we try to move as much intelligence as possible in the hands of the pilot and only do the heavy lifting, the low-level calculations inside the march. So the march in the testing phase, we're going to have two different testing phases. We're going to have the pre-recorded gait and the point-and-go system. So let's talk about the pre-recorded gait for a moment. Inside the joints of the march, we have different kinds of sensors, but the most important sensors are the encoders, with which we can measure the angles of the joints. So the idea is that we put on the suit ourselves, and we just walk with it, and we put it on record mode. So what we're doing is we're pre-recording a gait or a walking cycle, and this is basically what most commercial exoskeletons out there currently do. And the reason we do that is that we can easily test systems and have our pilot really easily transfer into our exoskeleton. So after our pilot's gotten used to walking with a pre-recorded gait, we're going to move over to the point and go, and this is where the fun begins. For the point and go, the idea behind that is that you take the crutch, which is basically the input device with a custom handle, and you point it to the ground, and the exoskeleton moves into that direction. So no more hassling with any other form of input device where you have to say, all right, walk or stop or turn. No, you point the crutch to the ground and the exoskeleton moves. So this time you are in control. The user is the pilot. So what's next? What if, let's say, the pilot wants to put the crutch somewhere too far for the exoskeleton to actually reach with its feet? What happens then? Well, imagine a box, a virtual box around the exoskeleton. That is the permissible box where the input will be registered. So if you place your crutch outside of that virtual box, the pilot will get feedback in the form of haptic feedback. So there are little vibrating motors inside the crutch, just like your phone, and it will tell the pilot what you're doing is not right. You cannot take a step there. So with this idea, we put the pilot in control. And the coming few weeks, we will be assembling the march, and we will have the pilot start testing. And during this testing phase, we will keep adding new features and features up until the Cybathlon. So we'll be extending the features of the march up until the race. And with the feedback that the pilot gives us, we can truly create an amazing device that will not only allow us to compete and win at the Cybathlon, but also to contribute something to society, which we believe is absolutely great. This concludes the technical overview, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Nick. Well, maybe it's not really up to me to say, but it's absolutely gorgeous. I like the design, and I hope you like the design too. But for now, we've seen the design of the exoskeleton. We've seen the features the exoskeleton has to have to compete in the Cybathlon. And you've been hearing about the pilot, and we're still not having a good picture of the pilot. Who is the pilot? This is why I want to welcome Claudia on stage. Claudia is a team member of Project Mars and the pilot of the exoskeleton. The oncoming bit of the presentation will be in Dutch, but please don't worry. We've put an English translation on the slide, and you can just read along. Ladies and gentlemen, with a warm applause, Claudia.
Ja, dankjewel, Sjoerd. Zie je het? Goedenavond allemaal. Zoals jullie al gehoord hebben, mijn naam is Claudia Boskomeis en ik ben de piloot van March. Ik moet zeggen, ik ben even erg onder de indruk van wat ik net gezien heb. Ik weet niet hoe het bij jullie overkomt, maar ik ga daar dus straks in lopen. Dus ja, ik heb eventjes zoiets van, wauw. Alle deelnemers van de Cybathlon in de categorie van het exoskelet zijn deelnemers die een dwarslesie hebben. Ik wil jullie even kort mee terugnemen in de tijd. 11,5 jaar geleden zei ik tegen mijn collega's op een vrijdagmiddag, fijn weekend allemaal, tot vrijdag of tot maandag. Dat liep anders. Een uur later, tijdens het trainen van een van de jonge paarden, kwam ik ten val. En ging het mis. Ik kwam vol op mijn rug terecht en ik had eigenlijk vrijwel direct in de gaten dat het foute boel was. Ik voelde mijn benen niet meer en ik kon ze ook niet meer bewegen. Tegen mijn vrienden die er op dat moment bij waren, zei ik van bel maar een ambulance, want ik zal nooit meer kunnen lopen. In het ziekenhuis werd bevestigd waar ik al bang voor was. Een complete dwarslesie, toracaal 12. Dat wil zeggen dat mijn beide benen verlamd zijn. Ik ben dus geschikt als piloot. Hoe komen ze aan de piloot? Eind vorig jaar werd ik benaderd door de Sint Maartenskliniek. En deze kliniek heb ik gerevalideerd na mijn ongeval. Een team uit Delft, of er is in de Sint Maartenskliniek sinds kort een wetenschappelijk onderzoek gestart met mensen die een dwarslesie hebben en lopen in een exoskelet. Het team uit Delft heeft daar navraag gedaan of zij iemand wisten die geschikt zou zijn voor hun exoskelet March en iemand die de uitdaging mee aan wilde gaan om de eerste bionische Olympische Spelen mee te vertegenwoordigen. Nou, die hadden zij wel een aantal en die hebben zij dus zodoende ook benaderd. Nou, daar zat ik dus zelf ook bij. En toen ik van dit project hoorde, was ik natuurlijk meteen razend enthousiast. Ja, weer kunnen lopen. Wie wil dat niet? Lijkt mij. Dus, en dan ook nog mee mogen doen aan de eerste bionische Olympische Spelen. Ja, wauw. Dus ik wilde die uitdaging graag aangaan. Om een lang verhaal kort te maken, ik ben geschikt. En ik sta hier en we hebben net het geweldige pak gezien. Dus ja, ik kan eigenlijk niet wachten. Onlangs, 11,5 jaar later dus, begin dit jaar, ben ik begonnen in de Sint Maartenskliniek met het lopen in een exoskelet, een andere exoskelet. Dit vergt nog erg veel. De eerste keer dat ik ging staan was, wauw, het voelde weer als van ouds. Het staan, het lopen, mensen op hoge ooghoogte kunnen aankijken. Ik had dit trouwens niet verwacht, dat dit nog zo'n impact zou hebben op mij, na 11 jaar zitten. Het is dus blijkbaar erg belangrijk dat ja, de wereld op ooghoogte te blijven en niet op de hoogte waarop ik nu zit. Het lopen heeft wel behoorlijk wat inspanning gevergd, zowel mentaal als fysiek. Probeert u zich eens voor te stellen. U heeft geen gevoel in uw benen, u voelt uw voeten niet en u moet gaan lopen. U weet dus niet waar uw benen staan of uw voet überhaupt goed staat. U heeft geen balans, dus u kunt voorovervallen, achterovervallen, als u geen ondersteuning heeft van de krukken. Ik wil een klein stukje laten zien van de film Die is opgenomen, ongeveer trainingssessie nummer 20 geweest. We trainen ongeveer elke keer een uurtje. En het is vrij intensief, ook mentaal. Bij dit skelet heb ik een horloge om, wat ik bedien, om het in beweging te zetten. Moet ik wel zelf doen, daar heb ik een aantal seconden de tijd voor. Dit zijn de eerste meters dat ik echt zelfstandig aan het lopen ben. Mijn fysiotherapeut loopt erachter voor als het misgaat. En ook het stoppen moet je beheersen. Staat er helaas niet op. Als je loopt in het exoskelet, moet je dus ook bepaalde vaardigheden beheersen. Doe je dit dus niet helemaal goed, dan gaat het mis. Of loopt het pak met mij dus gewoon door. Nou ja, gewoon. Ik zeg dan stop, stop, stop. Maar dan reageert het pak niet zo op. Gelukkig staan mijn therapeuten wel erg alert op dat moment. Mijn training in de Sint-Maartenskliniek zit er nu bijna op. Dan mag er weer iemand anders met het wetenschappelijk onderzoek mee gaan doen. En ik ga dan verder met March. Het skelet wat ik hier net gezien heb. En ik heb erg hoge verwachtingen ondertussen. Dus ik ga hard mijn best doen om het parcours te lopen. Het parcours is net al een beetje uitgelegd. 6 hindernissen die ik moet gaan doen. Probeer weer even terug te denken. Het gevoel wat ik u heb beschreven, wat ik ervaar als ik loop. Dus geen gevoel heb in mijn benen. Niet weet waar mijn voeten staan. En ook geen balans heb. Ik zal gaan opstaan vanuit een fauteuil. Daarna zal ik een slalom lopen. Vervolgens ga ik een schuine helling op. Moet ik een deur openen. Door de deur, deur weer dicht doen. Schuine helling naar beneden. Vervolgens 5 traptreden op, een stukje vooruit. 5 traptreden naar beneden. Zonder gebruik te maken van de leuning. Daarna het stukje ongelijk terrein. En de tegels die in een soort lava liggen. Dus je mag alleen met je krukken en je voeten op die tegels. Ja. Als ze mij dit begin van het jaar verteld had, had ik echt gezegd van, oké, ja, goed. Nu heb ik het net gezien, dit gaat gewoon goed komen. Ik heb een erg hoge verwachting, maar dit gaan wij gewoon doen in oktober. Dan als laatste, de techniek in de medische zorgwereld gaat erg snel. Verwacht wordt binnen nu en een korte tijd dat mensen die een dwarslesie oplopen, het ziekenhuis gaan revalideren en daarna weer lopend naar huis gaan. Nu is het lopen vooral nog therapeutisch, maar al een enorme verbetering kwaliteit van leven. Zowel mentaal als fysiek. Denk aan een betere blaasdarmfunctie voor mensen die een dwarslesie hebben. Denk aan minder rugklachten en misschien zelfs op termijn minder zenuwpijn. Wat echt voor sommige mensen echt heel heftig kan zijn. Denk aan een betere doorbloeding. Wat dus zorgt dat de decubitus gaat afnemen. Decubitus is doorlichtplekken, doorlichtwondjes. En dat is een van de ergste dingen, denk ik, die als dwarslesie patiënt, ja, laat ik het op dat moment maar even zo zeggen, kan overkomen. Als je een wondje hebt, bijvoorbeeld op je bil, dan moet het voor genezing ontlast worden. Nou, ja, als ik niet kan lopen en ik kan niet op in mijn rolstoel zitten, wat kan ik dan? Alleen maar op bed liggen, op mijn buik of op mijn zij. Ja. Je snapt natuurlijk wel wat voor een enorme impact dat heeft. En dan hebben we het niet over weken. Nee, die genezing duurt vaak maanden. En gaat ook nog gepaard vaak met ziekenhuisopnames. Ja, dit wil je natuurlijk niet. In dagelijkse leven zo terugvallen dat je bijvoorbeeld een half jaar opgenomen moet worden in een ziekenhuis. Daarom vind ik dat zorgverzekeraars die exoskeletten moeten gaan vergoeden. Het is nog geen vervanging van de rolstoel. Maar wel een enorme verandering dat je kan zitten en lopen kan afwisselen. Zodat je je lichamelijke conditie en je gewoon kan verbeteren. Waardoor er minder ziekenhuisopnames nodig zijn, vooral voor decubitus. En waardoor de kwaliteit van leven echt vele malen op vooruit gaat. Daarom ben ik echt blij dat ik hier mijn steentje aan mag bijdragen. En dat ik de piloot ben van dit mooie Exoskelet March. Dankjewel voor jullie aandacht.
Yes, thank you, Claudia. And although, of course, the team already knows you for a while, it's still a really intriguing story. And we're very happy to have you on the team because your enthusiasm really motivates us as a team to build the best exoskeleton. And we're going to nail the cybathlon. I'm sure of that. This now brings us to an end of the presentation. And I'm sure there are some questions let's start with the audience. And I would like to invite Nick and Jelle on stage again. Claudia, you can come in. So, we have a really handy device for this. It's called a catch box. I'll show you one here. There's a microphone in the catch box. And at the moment you have a question, you can catch the box that has been thrown at you. And you just
speak into the box.
And we hear the question. So, are there any questions? Yes, question in the back. Ronald. Throw it!
Okay, thank you. It ends in October. What's the follow-up for the TU Delft?
I think I can give this question to Jelle, the team manager.
After October, of course, we won't be finished yet. At least Project March will continue, and the innovation within the exoskeleton will keep improving the exoskeleton even further. In the coming months, we'll start the new recruitment of the new team that is going to continue after we finish in October. And we'll take them through the last bit of our team and run them through the how to do the team. And from that point on, we're going to continue this quick innovation in exoskeleton and rehabilitation devices.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Does the government already participate in this project?
No, the government is not participating in our project, at least. There are, at the moment, as I showed through the presentation, there were a few questions in the Tweede Kamer about exoskeletons and insurance companies. So the story is starting to live, but that's it at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any next questions?
What about the questions from the live stream?
Maybe there's a question in the live stream. Zeg, Mike, is there a question from the live stream?
Yes, there is. Someone is asking, how heavy is the exoskeleton?
I think that one's for me, right?
I think this one is for you, Chief.
Yeah. Okay, so how heavy is the exoskeleton? That's a good question. We don't know. Well, you do know. We haven't built it yet, so we're not sure of the exact weight of the exoskeleton, but we estimate it to be around 20 kilograms. It really depends on the weight of the batteries. We're starting off with big batteries because we need to have it run for a long time during testing. The Sabathlon only lasts for 15 minutes, basically. You only have 15 minutes to complete the course. So depending on how much power everything is draining during the testing phase, we can scale down the batteries if necessary. It will weigh maximum of about 25 kilograms and can go down all the way to about 17 kilograms. Really depends on the weight of the batteries.
Okay, thank you. Oh, that's the next question. Yeah. The cat's box is on its way.
Hello, Henk van der Meent from Nijmegen. I have two questions. The first one is, what is the maximum speed you can have with this exoskeleton? Yeah. And the second is, I understand that you need the crutch for steering the device, but it would be interesting if it could also walk without crutches.
Okay, so the first question, how fast is the device? Well, we're aiming at a speed of 1 meter per second, 1 meter per second, 1 kilometer, 1 meter per second, which is basically 3.6 kilometers.
1 meter.
Yeah, which is basically 3.6 kilometers an hour, which is the average speed of a stroll through the park or in the grocery store or in town, which is a normal, which is the normal speed for a human gait. So basically when you're walking around normally, it's about 1 meter per second. So that's the speed that we're aiming at. Might be a bit less, might be a bit more, depending on what's comfortable for Claudia, depending on her feedback. Like I said, we tuned the exoskeleton to her feedback. And the second question was?
Without crutches.
Without crutches. Of course, that's the dream. Everyone wants an exoskeleton without crutches, but technology is not right there yet because you don't really have a way of telling the exoskeleton where to go without those crutches. If you go like rewalk style where the gait is pre-recorded and you just play it back, then you could get away without crutches if you have some really fancy algorithm to have it stable all the time. But for now, we're using the crutches because our goal is to have the pilot in control and not have the exoskeleton walk the pilot. So it is possible, but it's something for in the future where you can somehow have the brain tell the exoskeleton what to do. But currently, we have to use...
But could you use a watch and just steer where you want to go?
That could be possible. We haven't looked into something like that before. Like I said, the technology is not quite there yet to do something like that. It is obviously something that people are thinking about. We are not focusing on that right now. What we are focusing on is pointing the crutch, the point of go system, pointing the crutch and have the exoskeleton go there. The reason for that is it has its benefits because you are in control, and pointing with your watch, then you would have to walk like this all the time. I mean, could look cool somehow, but I don't know. I don't think Claudia will really enjoy walking like this all the time. It is something that different teams can look at. I'm sure a lot of research is being done about that, but yeah. We are not actively researching that right now.
One last question, Claudia. You can I talk to you in English? Je loopt nu in het Rewalk exoskelet, hè?
Ja.
En dat is ongeveer met 0,3 meter per seconde.
Ja, die gaat niet zo heel erg snel, maar soms wel wat sneller.
Ja, maar kun jij je voorstellen dat dat zo snel gaat?
Ik moet zeggen dat je nog heel erg gefocust bent om op de techniek om te lopen. En voor mij mag het op zich, als je eigenlijk alles goed onder controle hebt, ja, laat hem maar sneller lopen. Ja, dan winnen we ook.
Exactly the enthusiasm I've been talking about.
Hun bouwen de techniek en de software en ik ga gewoon heel hard trainen om zo snel mogelijk dat parcours te lopen.
As I understand that the device is not ready at the moment and there is perhaps only a prototype. In 6-7 months, it's October. What's the risk that things are not going to happen?
Well, actually, next week, the first form of the exoskeleton will be put together. And in the coming weeks, we aim that in the end of April, the beginning of May, we'll have an exoskeleton which is functional for Claudia to walk in, which will have a pre-recorded gait, which is a nice transition from the rewalk she knows at the moment, to our own exoskeleton, and from that point on, we're going to improve step by step that she can get used to the new innovation we put in the exoskeleton, and every step learn towards the cybathlon.
I would also like to add to that we are already in production. We've been assembling the joints, we've been assembling the motors, so we are getting there. And it's not only a concept; it's already a physical product. We just have to put it together right
well,
now.
Well, it's because. Perhaps it's because of your age that you are so confirmed that things will happen. that is possible. But is there a plan B?
I must add to this.
Or is there a plan B that's only say, well, it's not going to happen?
Well, there is a plan B, actually, which is the Mindwalker. That is basically our backup exoskeleton, which has been our plan B since the beginning. It actually started out as a plan A, but then we said, all right, we want to build our own. So we started building our own. The Mindwalker is an existing exoskeleton which does a lot of things. It might not be able to perform everything at the Cybathon, but if you're asking if we have a plan B, yes, we do have a plan B, and that is an exoskeleton that we already have in the workshop. And the people who are actually joining us in the hall will be able to see the Mindwalker exoskeleton.
I have to add to this that at the end in the foyer, during the drinks, there will be a showcase in which some of the parts of the new exoskeleton are already presented to you. With a couple of teammates answering all your questions. So the actual parts of the exoskeleton march you can see downstairs.
And Claudia will do everything in the right order because she is a mother with a little boy. She has a job. And has she the time?
And a husband.
Well, perhaps she can tell us, what do you expect, Claudia?
What do I expect? I expect a lot. Ik ga over in het Nederlands. Ik verwacht eigenlijk van hun heel erg veel. Vooral omdat ik het een heel ambitieus plan vind. En nou ja, goed, de afstand tussen voor te trainen vanuit de, naar de TU Delft en mijn dagelijkse leven. Ik heb een zoontje van 16 maanden. Ik heb ook een baan. Dus ja, om het allemaal een beetje te combineren. Ja, we zullen moeten kijken hoe we het gaan doen. Maar ja, ik wil lopen. Ik wil echt lopen.
Thank you. And with this statement, I'd like to close the question round.
And
you've seen our faces, and Jelle told you already, we're 26. And of course, we also have partners. And I would like to have a warm applause for our partners. As I said at the beginning, we're not able to do this without their support. With this, I also like to invite our team to come on stage.
Come on stage.
You can see now the faces behind Project More. It's the faces that built this exoskeleton, the faces that designed this exoskeleton.
Claudia in the middle. Yeah, yeah, Claudia.
And I also like to invite Remco. Remco is of the St. Maartenskliniek. There he is. Hi, Remco. And he would like to say a couple of words to us. So, Remco, here you go.
Thank you. There should be some slides coming up. Is that?
I have the clicker. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Well, thank you very much, and thank you very much, Project March. My name is Remco Hoogendijk. I'm with the St. Martin's Clinic, and we are extremely proud to be a part of this great adventure. You know, we are a clinic that we are the first clinic that gave away an exoskeleton to a patient back home. You mentioned it before. And the guy is called Ruben, and Ruben started his crowdfunding campaign. So actually, Ruben is the first man in the Netherlands who owns his own exoskeleton. And he inspired us, because Ruben said, once I have funded my exoskeleton, I want to make this technology available for all of us. So the day we had this in the news, the next day, the inspection of healthcare was at our gates. What the heck are you think you're doing? Well, we're making the next steps in healthcare, and we're making the next steps in healthcare with a target group, with people with paraplegia, which is a very powerful group, very motivated people. We've met Claudia, but we've met Ruben, we've met a lot of other people. I want to show you one picture of how motivated these people are. We have another competition where we're in that's called the handbike battle, and these guys are cycling with their hands, try that. They're cycling 20 kilometers and they take 1,000 height meters in this battle. And you can guess which clinic won the last battle. That's us. So we are competitive. So we when we smell competition, we're in. So we smell competition here in Delft, in this beautiful university where a lot of young people inspire us, where young talents, you know, shifting at an entire year of their study and devoting that to this beautiful project and to our patients. And that's mind-boggling, and that's warming, and that's why so many great companies are joining Project March. So I want a big applause for the team of Project Mars, and I want to give them our full support. And from our part of the world where we come from, we never show up with empty hands, so we brought some beer from our brewery. I think it's called Heaven in English, but we say the Hemel. And this beer is called Marieken. I have six different types. It's downstairs for you, and you can, as a team, enjoy a nice beer for inspiration. And well, I wish you all the best in the Cybathon. Thank you.
With this, there's an end to the presentation, but it's not an end to the evening. We have drinks downstairs, and I will all like to invite you to join us. And please feel free to ask further questions downstairs. Thank you for your attention, thank you for showing up, and have a nice evening.